Hi, thanks so much for joining us today. Today, I'm really lucky to be joined by Corbb O'Connor, and we're going to talk a little bit today about technical digital accessibility and web accessibility. So I'd like to give Corbb a moment to introduce themselves and how they came to work in digital accessibility, and then how you got started, and what you functionally are doing now in your role in web accessibility.
Well, hello, I'm Corbb O'Connor. My pronouns are he, him, and his. I'm a white guy of Irish descent way back when, but I don't have the brogue. I'm so sorry. So right now I am the Director of Accessibility Advocacy at Level Access. Got started in digital accessibility via journalism. I studied journalism, wanted to be a journalist until I had to pretend I didn't have opinions. And it was actually that I was in the National Federation of the Blind Convention when we were working on the passage of a bill, still working on it today, to end sub-minimum wages for people with disabilities. And I realized as a journalist, I couldn't sign it. And it killed me because I knew that that kind of advocacy was super important to me. And so through a long and winding career of business-to-business communications, where perfectly fine to have an opinion, and then began U.S. Bank's accessibility program, through taking a lot of what I had learned in journalism and marketing, being a total nerd and teaching myself web development, and blending all that together with my personal experience as a screen reader user and as a magnification user, into what I'm doing today in accessibility.
That's a really interesting approach. And even though we've known one another for off and on, I didn't know that that's how you came into accessibility. Yeah. That's really interesting. I think everybody comes in different pathways. We should have some type of a map of how people come in. So I'm going to talk a little bit about first person experience and what that means for people working in technical web accessibility. How does that first person experience for multiple years, how do you find that to show value, and how does that differ from we've got lots of brilliant training and education resources, and we're lucky to work in a field where that's readily available. But can you speak a little bit about the value that first person experience brings on to a team or somebody working in a digital technical accessibility group?
Sure. This is Corbb. I think the biggest piece of it is really understanding the importance of various parts of accessibility. You know, we say from a conformance perspective, no one criterion is more important than another. But at the same time, on a practical level, when you're given a web page, we have to make prioritization decisions. And so as a user, I'm able to bring that voice in with the dev team, with a product team, with a design team, and say, okay, we only have so much time. We're not going to get there overnight. We do need to get there quickly. Here are the things that are going to make the user's experience better. The second part is that a lot of times we can have a site that we say, well, we want to follow an ARIA pattern. Okay, great. But if a user at the end of the day doesn't know how a tab panel is supposed to work, and they don't know that when they use their screen reader, they're going to drop in and out of forms mode and they need to turn that off, but they can't press escape because they're in a modal, but they're going to press that anyway. And then they're going to navigate to the content this way. Then we know that that's really not a workable solution. It's a great idea. It's a great pattern. But until users recognize that pattern and know how it works, then we're going to need to find some alternative ways to do it. It's just like in 2010. We first started seeing hamburger menus. No one knew what that was. We had to write the word menu underneath it. Now today, I will still tell you, it's still great to have text labels on your icons, but maybe there are some that we don't need as much anymore because users expect it. They know how it works. And the same is true with accessibility. We need to stay in touch with the user, which fortunately a lot of us are users on a daily basis. Unfortunately, some of us know too much. But we need to stay in touch with that first person user experience to really know what is the user going to expect, and how can we make that experience easy and accessible.
And Corbb, I laugh a little bit. I think there's some tech geek humor in all of that. But I think it's interesting as we meet people where they are and how they use whichever technology they have come to learn. I think the variance on how we test for people at different levels of familiarity or training even are important for the usability testing side of things. And oftentimes I will have to help people navigate in and out of forms mode. But if they've not been taught that, they don't know what that means. They just know the experience they're having. So it's a bit different on there. And I think that's important for people that are leading technical teams and design teams to understand that we can't make assumptions about every user. So I think that's in how we teach people to consider testing. So what kind of roles or responsibilities do you think somebody, if they're trying to illustrate that they've got more than 3 or 4 years of experience, what kind of descriptions of activities or responsibilities on a technical team would you expect to see? I know that could be on development or testing or audits, but can you give some examples of some of those functional roles or responsibilities that you might think you'd see?
This is Corbb. I think that the biggest piece to be mindful of is that we need people who really understand the software development lifecycle, the SDLC, from start to finish. Really understanding what does it mean when we talk about a user story or business requirements even. What does it mean when we talk about a wireframe? And how is that different than a mock-up? How does that then translate into annotations and then into user acceptance criteria and testing and on throughout the CI/CD or continuous integration, continuous deployment process? Because as accessibility specialists and consultants and analysts, we have to be able to talk one day to a product team, one day to a business leader, the next day to a designer, and the last day to a developer. We don't have to know their job backward and forward. We have to be able to have a conversation, and we have to make sure that they understand why does accessibility matter when you're a product owner? And what does that mean? Well, it matters because you need to be able to assign points to your sprint. And you need to understand what is the sizing of this accessibility story. And as much as we want to say accessibility is just part of every user story, for most teams, they're still paying back their technical debt. And so just like with our personal budgets, right, we're not going to be able to do everything we want to do tomorrow, today. We are still paying for yesterday's mistakes or choices. But I think the other big piece that we need to be mindful of is that a lot of people come in and they say, well, I know how to use assistive technology. It's important. We do need to know how to use assistive technology. We do need to understand that user perspective. But we also need to understand how does that fit into the larger picture of a business requirement? It would be great if we could just say, you know what? This release is dead because it's not accessible. Well, and if we do that too much, the company is no longer putting something into the world and we are bankrupt and we don't have any accessibility whatsoever. So, you know, while accessibility is important and it's our job to really keep the friendly pressure on the team, that's, by the way, a soft skill that's really important to have. How do you be firm and friendly? And then also, how do we balance that with the business need to be out in the world making money, putting new development out for our customers? And how do we keep moving accessibility forward all at the same time, even when those things are all at odds with one another?
Corbb, this is Sam. I really like the fact that as we talk to more of our colleagues that we keep hearing that web accessibility professionals need to be able to speak to those multiple parts of the teams and understand the process and the impact and how that relates to business strategy. I'm really pleased that we hear the same thing, and it's really great that we're reinforcing those concepts, and I hope that'll be helpful to people that are perhaps beginning their web accessibility professional journey or managing teams that are starting to incorporate web accessibility into their development, testing, or design processes. So Corbb, thanks so much for making time to join us today. We appreciate it. It's always lovely to get a chance to chat with you. And I appreciate you sharing your insights and your path into accessibility, both from a professional career and as a native user of AT as well.
This is Corbb. You're welcome.
Thanks so much for joining us today, y'all. We appreciate you making time. We'll talk more about web accessibility in the coming months.